Okay, guys, let's begin for all the night owls, for all those who probably not working tomorrow. Okay, we have our usual FOMC session. So what we normally do, right, is we just talk about what our expectation. Yeah, that's World Cup also. and after that, we will see what's the actual rate hike is like. And we will also stay through the entire press conference session. Okay, the press conference is actually at 3:30. So this FOMC session used to be earlier, but now due to the daylight saving, right, we are now 1 hour later. So currently market is kind of like pre-rallying before the FOMC. Okay, normally when I see pre-rally before market, it's kind of like a little bit scary, because I mean scary as in it tends to fall, okay, after the actual number come out, it tends to both. But as we have seen many times over this year FOMC, right, when the number comes out in, like, I believe 20 minutes time at 3 a.m., that is the first market reaction. And that reaction is normally a false reaction in the sense that it doesn't mean anything. The real reaction will come in when Jerome Powell actually make the press conference, okay? So we don't really want to sort of make any trade decision based on the initial price movement after the numbers come out. So it does seems like 50 basis point is pretty much confirmed. I'm pretty sure they are not going to make 75, okay, with the CPI coming down yesterday, right? From yesterday data, I don't really think they will make 75 basis point now. But are they going to make 25? Who knows? It does kind of seems like a little bit of possibility if the Federal Reserve take into account of yesterday data, mainly because the CPI and FOMC is now back to back, right? We don't really know how much of yesterday data FOMC is going to take into account. But we do have very interesting price action yesterday where initially the market rallied like really crazy, super duper crazy. It reached the height of like 4,140 lah, only to fall all the way back to 4,000 level. So meaning there was a swing of 140 points from the top like that. But right now we see that it is rallying back up again. It's recovering back up to like 4,060 like that, which is still about 80 points down from the top, And there are a lot of theories. and a lot of speculation on what happened here, okay? So I personally have my own theory also, but according to what people are saying, I would probably go with the fact that there are a few people who I kind of trust their analysis. So what they are saying is that the initial data came out, right? It is actually all the algorithm buying, okay? All the computer algorithm buying due to the CPI falling below the expectation. But once the price hit like the peak level, right, the actual seller are the human seller. Like, it is the computer buyers, and then we have the human selling coming in. Okay. But I truth to be told, I personally don't really have a lot of knowledge about how algorithm trading works on a institutional level or on a pension fund, those kind of level, okay? So if it is true that the humans are selling, right, it is the human trader who are selling into this rally, right, then what we do have is a situation where a 7.1% CPI is not really that, I would say, it's considered a great enough news for further rally, okay, because obviously there are a lot of offloading coming in, but still, right, whatever stuff that will be said in press conference later, it will definitely override what happened during this particular CPI price action. Okay, so let's not jump the gun too soon, and we see what Jerome Powell have to say. So once again, the 50 basis point number is not important. Market is not going to respond to that number, but definitely market will still move. So you may think that the market is responding to the 50 basis point number, but actually it's not. It's probably going to respond to more important stuff, mainly Jerome Powell message during the FOMC. But for today, right, it is actually quite different from other FOMC also, mainly because every three months, FOMC will provide a summary of economic projection. The last time we have was in September. So in December, we're going to have another one, and it is going to outline their forecast for the coming year. Okay. The reason why I say forecast for the coming year is because we are already in December. So I don't think they can make any forecast for December already. So most likely, we will have to see what is the forecast for 2023. So are they going to raise the rate for 2023, or are they going to maintain at 4.6, or will they decrease the rate? If they decrease the rate, right, it means to say that in 2023, we will have a pivot ready, because right now, if Federal Reserve raised by 50 basis point, right, federal fund rate will be at 4.5. And if they decrease the 2023 rate to like maybe 4.2, right, then it means that in 2023, Federal Reserve will start cutting from 4.5 to 4.25, like that, which I don't think is possible. I mean, it's not that probable, because in all the previous meeting, right, Federal Reserve did mention many, many times that it is still very complacent to think about cutting. They may reduce the pace of the hike. They may reduce the rate of the increment, but they are not going to cut the rate entirely. Okay. So based on September projection, right, you can see that the rate cut is actually going to come in 2024. In 2023, right, they are going to increase one small time, and then they will maintain. The cut will only come in 2024 and eventually 2025. So are we going to see this number being maintained, or this number actually increase? So of course, if this number decrease, right, then we will probably see the market rally. If this number maintain, right, then I don't think that market may go down, simply because I do think that all this rally happening recently, right, they are pricing in a lot of future rate cuts already, a lot of future rate cuts. So it does seems like perhaps market is pricing in a rate cut in 2023. And if the rate cut is not going to happen, right, then it is highly likely that market can fall back down. So the 50 basis point doesn't matter. The number doesn't matter. So don't always blindly look at the number and then, oh, number up, I short, number down, I long, that kind of trading style. Okay, it doesn't work here. We do have to look a little deeper into what is the future projection like, and not only that, right, what is the what do we think the current market is pricing in now, okay? So it is very possible for market to just rally beyond and then undo this entire swing down, right? But it is also possible that the sellers are starting to come in. So we don't really know what will happen later. We just have to wait and listen. So just a little update on my open position. Also, I have clear off Palantir and Zoom ready. These are spread trades, so I decide to clear off both. Okay, simply because they were in a good profit. My Zoom profit was around 1,400, like that, profit, but my Palantir was losing like about $600. So the net difference is about $700 to $800, which come to about sing 1,000 plus. Okay, so considering that this is a spread trade, right, a profit of $1,000 plus is, I feel that it is very, very good. So the reason why I say it is very good is because for those who remember, right, that particular spread trade is actually taken in 16th of November. We took that trade sometime here, around 16th of November. And during this period, right, you can see how market up, down, rally, up, down. But when I take the spread trade, right, I don't need to worry about anything. I just one long, one short, and my target is that hopefully the short will go down more than the long if market crash, or if the market rally, right, the long will go up more than the short, lah, okay? So wherever the market is headed, I will still get the profit nonetheless. It is just that the profit will not be very, very aggressive profit, lah. But if you are in a situation where you are unsure which direction the market is heading, or maybe market is very near resistant, or if there are high impact data coming in a very short period of time, right? Then it is good to take a spread trade simply because of the fact that spread trade are not affected by market movement. Spread trade are actually affected by the risk of the stock itself. Whether this stock is good or this stock is bad, it is not affected by a broad-based market movement, broad-based up move or broad-based down move. So I actually hold the spread through this rally, through this retrace, and then through this rally again, and then through the intraday retrace again, and overall it is still profitable. So if you are able to pick your spread trade very, very carefully, and if you perform the spread trade in a proper manner, right, regardless market up or down, you will still be profit nonetheless. So that's how we maintain our profit level through all this kind of market uncertainty and market volatility. And in fact, right, actually, even though my overall portfolio is a short bias portfolio, yesterday my portfolio actually went up simply because the longs are going up more than my shorts, and then some of the shorts are still going down. For example, yesterday Dillard went down, and I think CCL went down also. CarMax was like stagnant, so it doesn't really move that much. But Royal Gold actually rallies a lot. Whirlpool was stuck, and Palantir also rallied a lot, which is why I decide to cut it off. Okay. So the way how I trade is that I don't really look at individual trade. I look at my portfolio as a whole. As long as my portfolio is doing pretty much green, right, then this particular portfolio is good for now. And then I will start at additional spread trade, or I will take more directional trade, like maybe to the downside, to the upside, depending on what the macros are doing. Okay. So right now, we will be listening to FOMC. And after that, we shall look at the number. We shall look at the press conference. And then do be reminded that in the coming week, in the following week, right, next week, we do have earnings for both CarMax and the Carnival Cruise, okay? So we do have some more price action going next week. So if you are holding on to the YOLO trades such as Facebook put option or Nvidia put option, right, those are expiring next week. So we currently don't really know what the FOMC will be like, but there is still time, there is still chance for those options to be profitable. Unfortunately, if you have the SPY option instead, yes, we still have two, three more days. We shall see how. It is very possible that later Jerome Powell says something and then this whole thing dropped like 200 points, which is perfectly possible also. So don't let go of your option before the expiry date, okay? Especially if they are in the red, because there are many times where we have the last day miracle, okay? On that day, on the day of expiry, we have big, big movement which push the option into a profitable range. So let's just wait and see what is going to happen. We do have VIX coming down. We do have VIX coming down a bit, but I think this VIX, it doesn't really matter what it's doing now, because eventually after the FOMC, we will see the real direction. Okay. So 5 minutes away, 5 minutes away. Let's see how will things do that. We already have some volatility coming in now, okay? One minute. It's laggy.
Lisa, if you compare the September projections with the March projections, they were definitely a move in a more realistic direction. So I believe in September, the committee, the median participant, had the unemployment rate rising to 4.4, which would be about a 1-point rise over the lowest level that we've seen. Now, historically, we all know the Sahm-Dudley rule of thumb, which is if you get more than 0.4 rise in unemployment in the past, it's always been a recession. So I would argue implicitly, although Chair Powell may not use the R word today, their forecast is more or less consistent, I think, with a modest recession. The last thing I'll say is I've gone back and looked, and the two mildest recessions in the last 30 years were in 1990 and in 2001. In both of those, they only lasted 8 or 9 months, but in both of those, the unemployment rate rose about 1.5 points. So if we were to get a recession with a 1-point rise in unemployment, it would be something that we've not seen, which is really Priya's point.
Priya, not your confidence out 12 months, but even your confidence in where the markets are out 3 or 4 Fed meetings. What's your confidence into May or June?
It's low. I mean, I should say the market is less liquid. So we get these really wild moves, very hard to pick a narrative. You talk about confidence on the market. With a market that's less liquid, it should be a little lower. I think this year has taught us all humility, and certainly me. But in terms of confidence, I go back to John's question on growth versus inflation. I think my inflation uncertainty is going down. I am concerned about service inflation. Growth uncertainty is what is going to continue to pick up. And so that's when going into the middle of next year, I mean, have they reached terminal? When does the Fed respond? What is the threshold? I hope Chair Powell can explain what's the threshold for the Fed to stop versus, slow down is here, to stop hiking, to start to cut rates. You know, what is their estimate of Nehru? Do they need the unemployment rate at 5 to start to ease, or is it higher? I think those are all questions. So that's going to increase uncertainty around the middle of the year, because I think we're going to see weaker growth data for sure. And then we're all going to look at the Fed and they'll say they're resolute. And that's going to be very hard to trade for any asset class.
I can tell you, Bramo just started laughing at me as I looked at the starting 11 for the game in about 3 minutes' time.
I look over.
Couldn't contain it.
I just see a complete line.
I am not yet.
You're there.
It's multitasking.
Claire has to go, but it's just to watch.
That's why he wants to go.
Yeah, exactly.
Rich, I want to finish on this. It's an important question. We've seen financial conditions ease since the last meeting. Rich, based on the data, would you describe that as an unwarranted easing of financial conditions, or is it justified?
It's certainly not unwarranted. Look, inflation is public enemy number one. We got two good prints in a row on inflation. So, yes, there's obviously a macro input. Calibrating how much of the easing, makes sense in terms of a model, I mean, that's a matter of judgment. But I think we're going to continue, John, to see this tug of war between the data and the Fed really throughout much of next year, because their models are telling them to succeed and get inflation down into the twos, they need to keep policy restrictive, but if markets keep easing financial conditions, the restrictive policy loses its bite. So stay tuned. This is going to be with us for a while.
Well, we're going to find out in the news conference, I think, in just 30 minutes' time, Tom. Priya Misra, Richard Clarida, to the two of you, absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, thank you.
As always, going into this Fed decision. TK, there's going to be some questions about that in the news conference, no doubt about it.
Priya Misra, the single smartest thing I've heard in the last 24 hours, and it goes to all this Bitcoin crypto malarkey we're talking about. She said humility is in order, and the distinctive feature at this central bank are frontline academics like Richard Clarida and DSG. I mentioned Rick Michigan, his colleague at Columbia here 20 years ago. I mentioned Blinder today. Of other, these people have hardwired, built-in humility over how hard this is.
I think also scarred by the experience of the last couple of years, and for that matter, Lisa, the last 12 months. 12 months ago, looking out 12 months, how wrong could we be about where many people thought rates would end up the year?
Yeah, I don't think anyone needs lesson in humility. I think everyone's gotten one. And I think that that's
conditioned by it.
Exactly. And I think that there is a feeling of exhaustion more than anything right now, because people feel like, okay, well, we don't know what's coming. We don't want to have a downturn. We're exhausted by all of the negativity. We heard that earlier today. And yet, how positive can you be with a 4.5% to 5% Fed funds rate for a longer period of time?
If I sat here 12 months ago and said we'd be staring down the barrel of a 5 handle on Fed funds,
people would laugh at you.
They would have laughed at me 12 months ago, right?
Yeah, well,
it just
people
was not
did.
On the radar.
I mean, we have Bill Dudley. He's coming up, and people laughed at him.
It.
He did, and people said, this is crazy. We aren't going to get there. It'll blow up the financial system.
I remember that.
Okay, we do have a lot of initial reaction, but as mentioned, right, this is initial reaction. I don't get too excited because once the press conference come, right, we are going to have the real movement. Okay, so we do have 50 basis point high, but the important one is the FOMC economic projection. Okay, let's look at the economic projection. Let's see if it's out already or not. Okay, projection is out. Anyone want to make a guess? Anyone want to make a guess? How much will the 2023 projection will be? 4.6, 5.0, 4.2. Anyone? Before I scroll down. Bye. Throw a number, 5.0. Let's look. 5.1. So market will probably react to this, okay? So currently market is reacting to this, not the 50 basis point. It is because you look at last year and last September and this round, right? It is still 4.4. December is 4.4 already. So it is guaranteed chop 50 basis point high already, but now market is reacting to the 5.1. So we don't know how much the extent of this downwards movement will be. So hopefully later when Jerome Powell come out and speak, right, he will be a little bit more hawkish so that market goes down even more. Okay, but still, right, if you have your Tiger app on, I really, really recommend against trading this current action. Okay, if you want to put a trade in, it should be yesterday already, because things can really go either way. So as mentioned yesterday, right, of our initial trade plan, where it is very possible we have this up move and then after that we will see a down move during FOMC. So that is why we want to hold our option across this period. Okay. And this is also why option is a better choice if you are making this kind of YOLO trade. Simply because, right, if you short a stock yesterday like Nvidia, right, most likely you're gonna hit the stop loss. So you'll be forced to cut, because even if you confident about today price movement, if you hold on to your trade, right, what can happen is that what if today price rally some more? Now you will be back holding a very, very big losing position already. But if you have option, right, since your risk is limited to whatever your option contract is, you can still confidently hold even though market rally yesterday. Okay, so I cross finger, hope that everything will be like towards the downside and our put option can get money okay, by next week for those with Facebook or whatever, or even those with SPY, right? I think it may be a bit hard for SPY option to profit, but let's not rule that out also, because if market goes down like 150 points after Jerome Powell press conference, then perhaps maybe we still have the chance. Okay, so let's just wait for Jerome Powell press conference. You can watch the first 30 minutes of your workout, okay? And then we come back and then we come back at 3:30, okay? So right now let's just look at some of the stuff. CarMax straight away gone down. Carnival kind of like doing okay like that, like not sure what's going on. We also have Dillard. Holy crap, this is like my conviction paying off. My conviction on my trade is paying off. Construction partner up, Whirlpool is down. Aside from that, what else do we have? Yeah, I think CarMax and Carnival only, okay. But overall market is down. Let's see how's my position doing. Yeah, it went up from 2001 to 2005, okay? So I'm not really, really sure which portion of it is contributing to the profit, but of course I do think it's the short side, okay? So let's come back at 3:30, okay? I will still be here, but I'm going to the washroom for a while. After that, I'll be back and then I'll just describe whatever I see, okay? So I'll be back in a while. But surprisingly, the yield is not really shooting up a lot. The yield is like quite normal. I will also expect the today price action to be below yesterday, okay? I really would expect today price action to be below yesterday. But once again, we have to be careful about Jerome Powell's speech because it can just go back up also. We don't really know, We don't really know. Be back in 5 minutes, okay? Watch this for me. Let me see what's 4.1. What was the previous? 4.6, 3.9, 5.1, okay. I truly feel that this should put an end to the Fed pivot nonsense, I really hope, Okay, guys, I'm back. Hey, correct. I just want to say that I think can do one YOLO put option, okay? Can do one YOLO put option that expire this Friday, and then you buy the 400 strike price. You buy the 400 strike price. Let me put that now. The thing moving so fast. Wait on. It's moving too fast. Put one more YOLO, okay? Put SPY expire this Friday. This Friday got quad witching also. And then strike. Let's be a little more conservative now, okay? 399? Can we do a 399? 400 lah. This will, don't worry. This will respond soon. Wait. Let me put my trade first. Abi, no money really. Too many. Vix is waiting for Jerome Powell. Oh crap. The YOLO option, don't go crazy, okay? Because we are doing Friday expiry. So be careful. Be careful because power speech haven't come yet. I think going forward to January, right, or just going forward, I will probably be adopting more bearish portfolio. Okay. The new interface, I cannot take it. For SPY, SPY stock. The new interface for Tiger Mobile. Okay, option put expiry 16 December. Okay, I'm going to buy the 399 now. Okay, I'm going to buy 399, strike 399, $4.06. $4.60. Okay, so all the best. Be careful with your risk. Okay. So later we shall see what Jerome Powell said. So I bought the 399 lah. So 399, I got at 4.6. Meaning to say, SPY need to go down to 394.4. Sorry, let's look at SPY. 394.4. Okay, I think doable. We shall see how later. Okay, you can see it is slowly recovering. So VIX have to be patient. Okay, what's the time now? 3:16, 15 more minutes to go. Let me put up the YouTube page. Hopefully Jerome Powell do some magic and then the whole thing just drop 100 points like that. Okay, Federal Reserve, live. Okay, now you see now VIX going green already. Okay, we do have the yield going, yield recovering back up. The yields are going back up. And then dollar, how about dollar? Dollar like cannot make it, eh? Like cannot make it like that. How's gold doing? Gold down a bit only, lah. Not by a lot. How is our trades doing? Okay, Whirlpool down 1%. This is good. So for those who missed the Whirlpool trade, original Whirlpool trade, you can still enter. You can still enter with your stop loss like somewhere there, I think. Okay. It is right at the entry. And in fact, we got even better candle here. This candle like telling you, okay, this should be the top here. Lah. Okay, so CarMax is negative already, Carnival going down there. So sad, Royal Gold. I think I may want to TP Royal Gold already. I may want to TP Royal Gold entirely already. Even the second entry one, I may want to let go. Louisiana also going down, Dealer going down. Dealer kind of recovered, just now it was down even more. How about The rest are Genera is still green. Scholl is still green. How's the U curve like? The U curve kind of recover a bit. Hong Kong. Oh yeah, for those who haven't TP your nano film, right? I highly suggest you TP ready. Seems like some selling coming here, okay? I personally TP ready. Anything else ongoing for Singapore stock? Not much, not much stuff going on. Geo Energy recover a bit. But Geo Energy also like going downtrend already. In the money, you can let it lapse, but make sure that we will let it lapse lah. If it profit, then it will Tiger will auto sell for you. But if let's say by later, right? By later, if it is really like the S&P continue to drop like another 100 points like that, I feel that it is safer to just TP lah, okay? Because normally option if we can get like 100% like that is considered good enough already lah. If you let it lapse, right? If you let it lapse, it will kind of try to exercise for you. It will convert to SPY shares for you. And let's say if your account has a lot of cash, right, then it will just get converted to SPY share. And then after that, you need to manually cover the SPY shares. So a lot of additional steps. But let's say if your account don't have sufficient money to exercise the option, right, then most likely it will get auto sell off by Tiger. But personally for me, right, if it is in the money or in the money or out of the money, my account is already usually at maximum. It doesn't have enough cash to get exercised. Okay, so it will get auto sell off. Okay, so it is going sideways until Jerome Powell speak. So nothing much to see here. Also, we did get that 50 points drop. Okay, so we are right at yesterday bottom. We are right at yesterday bottom, which is, I will say, it's still pretty high. Given how things are, it's still pretty high. I do expect it to go further downward. So I'm not sure if the further downside will come during this year or next year. So I think the January also got FOMC, right? Yeah, January also have FOMC. So next year, Jan, we will still have another round. I will let you guys know when I TP my option, okay? If let's say can TP later, we TP later. Okay, 8 more minutes. Okay, let's see what else do they have to say while we are waiting. Recent indicator point to modest growth in spending and production. Job gain have been robust in recent months, and the unemployment rate have remained low. Inflation remains elevated, reflecting supply-demand imbalance related to pandemic, higher food and energy prices, and broader price pressure. So in the eyes of Federal Reserve, right, inflation is still high, obviously, because we are still at 7.1. Russia's war against Ukraine is causing tremendous human and economic hardship. Why are they still talking about this? It's like now the issue is, I think, outside of Russia and Ukraine already. Look at the oil prices. The oil prices have been gone down so much already. I'm not so sure about the soft commodity, okay? But the oil prices is now no longer an issue. Talking about oil prices, where are the oil now? Oil is still up though. Okay. I thought I would expect oil to go down since dollar went up. The committee is highly attentive to inflation risk. The committee seeks to achieve maximum employment and inflation at the rate of 2% over the long run. In support of this goal, the committee decided to raise target federal fund rate to 4.25. The committee anticipates that ongoing increase in target range will be appropriate, meaning they are still going to increase. They are still going to increase. If they don't want to increase, they will say they will maintain the target range. Ongoing increase in the target range will be appropriate to attain a stance of monetary policy that is sufficiently restrictive to return inflation to 2% over time. In determining the pace of future increase, the target range, the committee will take into account the cumulative tightening monetary policy, cumulative meaning all the rate that they have done so far, and the lag with which monetary policy affect economic activity and inflation and economic and financial development. In addition, committee will continue to reduce its holding. So they are still going to reduce the holding with the plan that they have issued in May. Okay. Meaning they are not gonna slow down the reduction rate. They will still reduce at the current pace. Committee is strongly committed to return inflation to its 2%. In assessing appropriate stance of monetary policy, committee will continue to monitor the implication of incoming information for economic outlooks committee will be prepared to adjust the stance on monetary policy as appropriate if risks emerge that could impede the attainment of committee goal. The committee's assessment will take into account a wide range of information, including reading on public health, labor market condition, inflation pressure and inflation expectation, and financial and international development. Okay, so these are very protocol words, okay? but even though these are very protocol phrase, right, there are certain phrases that you need to watch out for, such as anticipate ongoing increase in target range. You can actually go and read all the statement that they issued previously, and you see how do they phrase certain thing. And by looking at this, right, you'll be able to see whether if they are like looking to reduce the rate or slow down the rate or whatever, okay? Best Buy recently also coming down. It is at this swing level. Below 4.55. Recovering though, should go down some more. Leh. CarMax 1.86. Carnival rate. Metal is still green. What is metal still green? But it did come down from a very big rally lah. Tesla like dying already. Like in the past few weeks, the market is rallying, but Tesla is like still jumping down. Coinbase rally. Okay, like compared to yesterday, it's very big difference. Okay, metal slowly coming down. Wingstop. BlackRock. Okay, today the defensive are green. Hey, 3:30 liao eh. Chop, I want to sleep one. But truth to be told, I was quite surprised that they still decide to go for 5.1 here. Even yesterday CPI, right? I was thinking like maybe they may cool down a bit, but actually they are still quite, I would say, aggressive in their policy stance. Okay, start. Monitor, let's go to 5 minutes. Okay, so when he starts speaking or whatever, it will swing like crazy one. So don't bother about this. Wait until he speak finish. Is it me or there's no sound? Okay. Is there no sound? Okay, got sound.
Good afternoon. Before I go into the details of today's meeting, I'd like to underscore for the American people that we understand the hardship that high inflation is causing and that we are strongly committed to bringing inflation back down to our 2% goal. Over the course of the year, we've taken forceful actions to tighten the stance of monetary policy. We've covered a lot of ground, and the full effects of our rapid tightening so far are yet to be felt. Even so, we have more work to do. Price stability is the responsibility of the Federal Reserve and serves as the bedrock of our economy. Without price stability, the economy doesn't work for anyone. In particular, without price stability, we will not achieve a sustained period of strong labor market conditions that benefit all. Today, the FOMC raised our policy interest rate by a half percentage point. We continue to anticipate that ongoing increases will be appropriate in order to attain a stance of monetary policy that is sufficiently restrictive to return inflation to 2% over time. In addition, we're continuing the process of significantly reducing the size of our balance sheet. Restoring price stability will likely require maintaining a restrictive policy stance for some time. I'll have more to say about today's monetary policy actions after briefly reviewing economic developments. The U.S. economy has slowed significantly from last year's rapid pace. Although real GDP rose at a pace of 2.9% last quarter, it is roughly unchanged through the first three quarters of this year. Recent indicators point to modest growth of spending and production this quarter. Growth in consumer spending has slowed from last year's rapid pace, in part reflecting lower real disposable income and tighter financial conditions. Activity in the housing sector has weakened significantly, largely reflecting higher mortgage rates. Higher interest rates and slower output growth also appear to be weighing on business fixed investment. As shown in our summary of economic projections, the median projection for real GDP growth stands at just 0.5% this year and next, well below the median estimate of the longer-run normal growth rate. Despite the slowdown in growth, the labor market remains extremely tight, with the unemployment rate near a 50-year low, job vacancies still very high, and wage growth elevated. Job gains have been robust, with employment rising by an average of 272,000 jobs per month over the last 3 months. Although job vacancies have moved below their highs and the pace of job gains has slowed from earlier in the year, the labor market continues to be out of balance, with demand substantially exceeding the supply of available workers. The labor force participation rate is little changed since the beginning of the year. FOMC participants expect supply and demand conditions in the labor market to come into better balance over time, easing upward pressures on wages and prices. The median projection in the SEP for the unemployment rate rises to 4.6% at the end of next year. Inflation remains well above our longer-run goal of 2%. Over the 12 months ending in October, total PCE prices rose 6%. Excluding the volatile food and energy categories, core PCE prices rose 5%. In November, the 12-month change in the CPI was 7.1%, and the change in the core CPI was 6%. The inflation data received so far for October and November show a welcome reduction in the monthly pace of price increases. But it will take substantially more evidence to give confidence that inflation is on a sustained downward path. Price pressures remain evident across a broad range of goods and services. Russia's war against Ukraine has boosted prices for energy and food, and has contributed to upward pressure on inflation. The median projection in the SEP for total PCE inflation is 5.6% this year and falls to 3.1% next year, 2.5% in 2024 and 2.1% in 2025. Participants continue to see risks to inflation as weighted to the upside. Despite elevated inflation, longer-term inflation expectations appear to remain well anchored, as reflected in a broad range of surveys of households, businesses, and forecasters, as well as measures from financial markets. But that is not grounds for complacency. The longer the current bout of high inflation continues, the greater the chance that expectations of higher inflation will become entrenched. The Fed's monetary policy actions are guided by our mandate to promote maximum employment and stable prices for the American people. My colleagues and I are acutely aware that high inflation imposes significant hardship as it erodes purchasing power, especially for those least able to meet the higher costs of essentials like food, housing, and transportation. We are highly attentive to the risks that high inflation poses to both sides of our mandate, and we are strongly committed to returning inflation to our 2% objective. At today's meeting, the committee raised the target range for the federal funds rate by a half percentage point, bringing the target range to 4.25% to 4.5%. And we are continuing the process of significantly reducing the size of our balance sheet. With today's action, we have raised interest rates by 4.25 percentage points this year. We continue to anticipate that ongoing increases in the target range for the federal funds rate will be appropriate in order to attain a stance of monetary policy that is sufficiently restrictive to return inflation to 2% over time. Over the course of the year, financial conditions have tightened significantly in response to our policy actions. Financial conditions fluctuate in the short term in response to many factors, but it is important that over time they reflect the policy restraint that we're putting in place to return inflation to 2%. We are seeing the effects on demand in the most interest-sensitive sectors of the economy, such as housing. It will take time, however, for the full effects of monetary restraint to be realized, especially on inflation. In light of the cumulative tightening of monetary policy and the lags with which monetary policy affects economic activity and inflation, the committee decided to raise interest rates by 50 basis points today, a step down from the 75 basis point pace seen over the previous four meetings. Of course, 50 basis points is still a historically large increase, and we still have some ways to go. As shown in the SEP, the median projection for the appropriate level of the federal funds rate is 5.1% at the end of next year, a half percentage point higher than projected in September. The median projection is 4.1% at the end of 2024 and 3.1% at the end of 2025, still above the median estimate of its longer run value. Of course, these projections do not represent a committee decision or plan, and no one knows with any certainty where the economy will be a year or more from now. Our decisions will depend on the totality of incoming data and their implications for the outlook for economic activity and inflation. And we will continue to make our decisions meeting by meeting and communicate our thinking as clearly as possible. We are taking forceful steps to moderate demand so that it comes into better alignment with supply. Our overarching focus is using our tools to bring inflation back down to our 2% goal and to keep longer-term inflation expectations well anchored. Reducing inflation is likely to require a sustained period of below-trend growth and some softening of labor market conditions. Restoring price stability is essential to set the stage for achieving maximum employment and stable prices over the long run. The historical record cautions strongly against prematurely loosening policy. We will stay the course until the job is done. To conclude, we understand that our actions affect communities, families, and businesses across the country. Everything we do is in service to our public mission. We at the Fed will do everything we can to achieve our maximum employment and price stability goals. Thank you. I will look forward to your questions.
Steve Leisman, CNBC. Thanks for taking my question, Mr. Chairman. You just talked about the importance of market conditions reflecting the policy restraint you put in place. Since the November meeting, the 10-year has declined by 60 basis points. Mortgage rates have come down. High-yield credit spreads have come in. The economy has accelerated, and the stock market's up 6%. Is this loosening of financial conditions a problem for the Fed and its effort and its fight against inflation? And if so, do you need to do something about that? And how would you do something about that? Thank you.
So as I mentioned, it is important that overall financial conditions continue to reflect the policy restraint that we're putting in place to bring inflation down to 2%. We think that financial conditions have tightened significantly in the past year, but our policy actions work through financial conditions, and those in turn affect economic activity, the labor market, and inflation. So what we control is our policy moves and the communications that we make. Financial conditions both anticipate and react to our actions. I would add that our focus is not on short-term moves, but on persistent moves. And many, many things, of course, move financial conditions over time. I would say it's our judgment today that we're not at a sufficiently restrictive policy stance yet, which is why we say that we would expect that ongoing hikes would be appropriate. And I would point you to the SEP again for our current assessment of what that peak level will be. As you will have seen, 19 people filled out the SEP this time, and 17 of those 19 wrote down a peak rate of 5% or more in the fives. So that's our best assessment today for what we think the peak rate will be. You will also know that at each subsequent SEP during the course of this year, we've actually increased our estimate of what that peak rate will be. And today, the SEP that we're published shows that, again, that overwhelmingly FOMC participants believe that inflation risks are to the upside. So I can't tell you confidently that we won't move up our estimate of the peak rate again at the next SEP. I don't know what we'll do. It will depend on future data. What we're writing down today is our best estimate of what we think that peak rate will be based on what we know. Obviously, if the inflation data come in worse, that could move up, and it could move down if inflation data are softer.
Gina Smilek, New York Times. Thanks for taking our questions. The SEP, like you mentioned, suggests that the Fed will be making another 0.75 percentage points worth of rate increases in 2023. I wonder if you would foresee that being in 25 basis point increments, 50 basis point increments, sort of how you see the speed playing out going forward. And then I wonder what you're looking at as you determine when to stop.
Yeah. As I've been saying, as we've gone through the course of this year, as we lifted off and got into the course of the year, and we saw how strong inflation was and how persistent, it was very important to move quickly. In fact, the speed, the pace with which we were moving was the most important thing. I think now that we're coming to the end of this year, we've raised 425 basis points this year, and we're into restrictive territory, it's now not so important how fast we go. It's far more important to think, what is the ultimate level? And then at a certain point, the question will become, how long do we remain restrictive? That will become the most important question. But I would say the most important question now is no longer the speed. So, and that applies to February as well. So I think we'll make the February decision based on the incoming data and where we see financial conditions, where we see the economy. And that'll be the key thing. But ultimately, that question about how high to raise rates is going to be one that we make looking at our progress on inflation, looking at where financial conditions are, and making an assessment of whether policy is restrictive enough. I've told you today we have an assessment that we're not at a restrictive enough stance, even with today's move, and we've laid out our own individual assessments of what we would need to do to get there. At a certain point, though, that we'll get to that point, and then the question will be, how long do we stay there? And the strong view on the committee is that we'll need to stay there, until we're really confident that inflation's coming down in a sustained way. And we think that will be some time. Now, why do I say that? If you you can break inflation down into three sort of buckets. The first is goods inflation, and we see now, as we've been expecting really for a year and a half, that supply conditions would get better. And ultimately, supply chains get fixed and demand settles down a little bit and maybe goes back to services a little bit, and we start to see goods inflation coming down. We're now starting to see that in this report and the last one. Then you go to housing services. We know the story there is that housing services inflation has been very, very high and will continue to go up, actually, as rents expire and have to be renewed. they're going to be renewed into a market where rates are higher than they were when the original leases were signed. But we see that the new leases that the rate for new leases is coming down. So once we work our way through that backlog, that inflation will come down sometime next year. The third piece, which is something like 55% of the index, PCE and core inflation index, is non-housing related core services. And that's really a function of the labor market largely. That's the biggest cost by far in that sector is labor. And we do see a very, very strong labor market, one where we haven't seen much softening, where job growth is very high, where wages are very high, vacancies are quite elevated, and really there's an imbalance in the labor market between supply and demand. So that part of it, which is the biggest part, is likely to take a substantial period to get down. The goods inflation has turned pretty quickly now, after not turning at all for a year and a half. Now it seems to be turning, but there's an expectation really that the services inflation will not move down so quickly, so that we'll have to stay at it, so that we may have to raise rates higher to get to where we want to go. And that's really why we are writing down those high rates and why we're expecting that they'll have to remain high for a time.
Howard Schneider with Reuters. Thanks for taking the question. You described GDP growth in the SEPs as moderate or modest, I believe. Yet it's really approaching stall speed. Half a percentage point is not much. You described labor market unemployment rate as representing some softening, but it's nearly a full percentage point rise, and that's well in excess of what has historically been associated with recession. Why wouldn't this be considered a recessionary projection by the Fed?
Well, I'll tell you what the projection is. I don't think it would qualify as a recession, though, because you've got positive growth. The expectations in the SEP are basically, as you said, which is we've got growth at a modest level, which is to say about a half a percentage point. That's positive growth. It's slow growth. It's well below trend. It's not going to feel like a boom. It's going to feel like very slow growth, right? In that condition, labor market conditions are softening a bit. Unemployment does go up a bit. I would say that many analysts believe that the natural rate of unemployment is actually elevated at this moment. So it's not clear that those forecasts of inflation are really much above the natural rate of unemployment. We can never identify its location with great precision. But that 4.7% is still a strong labor market. If you look, you've got the reports we get from the field are that companies are very reluctant to lay people off, other than the tech companies, which is a story unto itself. Generally, companies want to hold on to the workers they have because it's been very, very hard to hire. So, and you've got all these vacancies out there far in excess of the number of employed people. That doesn't sound like a labor market where a lot of people will need to be put out of work. So that there are channels through which the labor market can come back into balance with relatively modest increases in unemployment, we believe. None of that is guaranteed, but that is what their forecast reflects.
Nick. Thanks. Nick Timiraos of the Wall Street Journal. Chair Powell, I want to follow up on Gina's question. The decision to step down the pace of rate rises appears to have been socialized at your last meeting, largely before the past two CPI reports showed inflation decelerating in line with the committee's forecast this year. You just now talked about making decisions meeting by meeting and being mindful of the lags of policy. Does that mean, all things equal, you would feel more comfortable probing where the terminal rate is by moving in 25 basis point increments, including beginning at your next meeting?
So I haven't made a judgment on what size rate hike to make at the last meeting. But, what you said is broadly right, which is having moved so quickly and having now so much restraint that's still in the pipeline, we think that the appropriate thing to do now is to move to a slower pace. And, that will allow us to feel our way and get to that level, we think, and better balance the risks that we face. So that's the idea. It makes a lot of sense, it seems to me, particularly if you consider how far we've come. But again, I can't tell you today what the actual size of that will be. It will depend on a variety of factors, including the incoming data in particular, the state of the economy, the state of financial conditions.
With the CPI report, if it had come out last week, do you think it would have changed some of those
those forecasts in today's S&P?
No, absolutely not. No, as a matter of practice, the SEP reflects any data that comes out during the meeting. And participants know that they have they can make changes to their SEP during the meeting, you know, well in advance of the press conference so that we're not running around. But that's not the case. It's never the case that the SEPs don't reflect an important piece of data that came in on the first day of the meeting.
Rachel? Hi, Chair Powell. Rachel Siegel from The Washington Post. Thank you for taking our questions. I'm wondering if we could talk about the projection for the unemployment rate. Why has the Fed raised its unemployment projection? Is it because the model suggests that a higher terminal rate would automatically cause a higher unemployment rate? Or are you seeing signs that the labor market isn't quite as strong as we think it is now? Thanks.
No, it's not about the strength of the labor market. The labor market is clearly very strong. It is more just that, you know, by now, we've continually expected to make faster progress on inflation than we have, ultimately. And that's why the peak rate for this year goes up between this meeting and the September meeting. You see the fact that we've made less progress than expected on inflation. So that's why that goes up. And that's why unemployment goes up, because we're having to tighten policy more. And so it didn't go up by much in the meeting, I don't think, but that's the idea, is slower progress on inflation, tighter policy, probably higher rates, probably held for longer, just to get to where the kind of restriction that you need to get inflation down to 2%.
Do you have a sense of, in order to get to that number, how much of that could be caused by layoffs versus vacancies trimming or changes to the labor force population rate?
So it's very hard to say. You know, you can look at history, right? And history would say that in a situation like this, the declines in unemployment would be more meaningful, I think, than what you see written down there. But why do we think that is the case? So I'll give you a few reasons. First, just is that there's this huge overhang of vacancies, meaning that vacancies can come down a fair amount, and we're hearing from many companies that they don't want to lay people off, so that they'll keep people because it's been so hard. I mean, I think it feels like we have a structural labor shortage out there, where there are, you know, 4 million fewer people, a little more than 4 million, who are in the workforce available to work than there's demand for workforce. So the fact that there's a strong labor market, you know, means that companies will hold on to workers, and it means that it may take longer, but it also means that the costs in unemployment may be less. Again, that we're going to find out empirically, but I think that's a reasonably possible outcome, and you do hear, you know, many labor economists believe that it is. So we'll see, though.
Colby.
Thank you. Colby Smith with the Financial Times. How should we interpret the higher core inflation forecast for 2023 in the SEP? Does that not then suggest that the policy rate currently forecasted for next year should actually be higher than the 5.1 medium estimate penciled in?
Well, I think that's why one of the reasons it went up was that core came in stronger this year. Yeah, what you see is our best estimate as of today, for how high we need to raise rates, to how much we need to tighten policy to create enough, restrictive policy to slow economic activity and soften the labor market and bring inflation down through those channels. That is the estimate, best estimate we make today. And as I mentioned, we'll make another estimate for the next SEP, and we'll, you know, of course, between meetings we do the same thing, but we don't publish it.
Victoria.
Hi, Victoria Guida with Politico. I wanted to make sure I understand specifically what's going on in the SEP, because you all expect rates to go higher, but you're also more pessimistic about what inflation is going to look like next year. And I was just wondering, you know, given that we have seen some cooling in inflation, is that primarily because of wage growth, that you expect wage growth to be sort of a headwind?
No, we're going into next year with higher inflation than we had thought, right? So we're actually moving down to the level that we're moving down to next year is still a very large drop in inflation from where inflation is running now, well more than a 1% change in inflation. But remember that the jump-off point at the beginning of the year is higher. So, we're moving down still by a very large chunk. I don't think the policy is having any less effect. It's just starting from a higher level at the end of 2022. So we're getting down. I believe the median is 3.5%. That's a pretty significant drop in inflation. And you know, where's it coming from? It's coming from the goods sector, clearly. By the middle of next year, we should begin to see lower inflation from the housing services sector. And then, you know, the big question is how much will you see from the largest, the 55% of the index, which is the non-housing services sector. And, you know, that's where you need to see, we believe you need to see a better balancing of supply and demand in the labor market so that you have, it's not that we don't want wage increases, we want strong wage increases, we just want them to be at a level that's consistent with 2% inflation. Right now, if you factor in productivity estimates, standard productivity estimates, wages are running, you know, well above what would be consistent with 2% inflation.
Neil. Thanks. Hi, Chair Powell. Neil Irwin with Axios. Some of your colleagues have been pretty explicit that they can't imagine rate cuts happening in 2023. That's certainly not implied by the SEP. But futures markets have priced in some easing in the back half of next year. What's your view of the likelihood of any kind of rate cuts next year? What circumstances might make that plausible?
You know, our focus right now is really on moving our policy stance to one that is restrictive enough to assure a return of inflation to our 2% goal over time. It's not on rate cuts. And we think that we'll have to maintain a restrictive stance of policy for some time. Historical experience cautions strongly against prematurely loosening policy. I guess I would say it this way. I wouldn't see us considering rate cuts until the committee is confident that inflation is moving down to 2% in a sustained way. So that's the test I would articulate. And you're correct. There are not rate cuts in the SEP for 2023.
Steve. Steve Matthews with Bloomberg. Let me ask you about China. In the last few weeks, China has abandoned its COVID policy and been reopening pretty strongly. I'm wondering if you see that as disinflationary because you're seeing supply chains improve, or inflationary because it obviously brings a lot more demand globally, improves the global outlook for growth and for commodities prices.
And so you're right. Those two things will offset each other. Weaker output in China will push down on commodity prices, but it could interfere with supply chains ultimately, and that could push inflation up in the West. It's very hard to say, you know, how much how those two will offset each other. And it doesn't seem likely, actually, that the overall net effect would be material on us. But to your point, China faces a very challenging situation in reopening. And we've seen waves of COVID all around the world can interfere with economic activity. China, a very critical manufacturing place for manufacturing and exporting. Their supply chain is very important. China faces a reopening. They've backed away from their COVID restriction policies. There could be very significant increases in COVID, and we'll just have to see. It's a risky situation. But again, it doesn't seem like it's likely to have material overall effects on us.
Chris. Hi, Chris Rugaber at Associated Press. Thank you for taking my question. I wondered if you could comment a bit more about yesterday's inflation report. I mean, it showed inflation cooling in all three of the categories that you laid out at Brookings. Are you confident that you're seeing real progress on getting inflation under control? Are you still worried it could slip into some kind of unentrenched, you know, upward spiral? Thank you.
Right. So the data that we've received so far for October and November, we don't have we have some remaining data to get in November, but they clearly do show a welcome reduction in the monthly pace of price increases. As I mentioned in my opening statement, it will take substantially more evidence to give confidence that inflation is on a sustained downward path. So the way we think about this is this. This report is very much in line with what we've been expecting and hoping for. And what it does is it provides greater confidence in our forecast of declining inflation. As I mentioned, we've been expecting, forecasting significant declines in overall inflation and core inflation in the coming year, and this is the kind of reading that it will take to support that. So really, this gives us greater confidence in our forecast rather than at this point changing our forecast. In terms of the pieces, we have been expecting goods inflation to come down as supply chain pressures eased. That's happening now. Housing services, as I mentioned, there is good news in the pipeline. As long as new housing leases show declining inflation, that will show up in the measure around the middle of next year, so that should help. And the big piece, again, is core services ex housing, which is very important, and we have a ways to go there. You do see some beginning signs there, but ultimately that's the big, that more than half, as I mentioned, of PCE core index, and it's very fundamentally about the labor market and wages. If you look at wages, look at the average hourly earnings number we got with the last payrolls report. You don't really see much progress in terms of our average hourly earnings coming down. Now there may be composition effects and other effects in that, so we don't put too much weight on any one report. These things can be volatile month to month, but we'll be looking for wages moving, you know, down to more normal levels where workers are doing well and ultimately their gains are not being eaten up by inflation.
Michael McKee from Bloomberg Radio and Television. There's a little bit of a disconnect between the optimistic view you just expressed about the economy and the changes that you've made in the SEP. And I'm wondering if you're reacting to the fact that the markets have loosened financial conditions, or if you feel the Fed may be a little bit behind on inflation, whether the recent disinflation we're seeing is transitory or not, and how this affects the idea of a soft landing if you're projecting just 0.5% growth for this year.
So if I think I got your question. So, you know, one thing is to say is I think our policies in getting into a pretty good place now. We're restrictive, and I think we're getting close to that level of sufficiently restrictive. We laid out today what our best estimates are to get there. It boils down to how long do we think this process is going to take? And of course, we welcome these better inflation reports for the last 2 months. They're very welcome, but I think we're realistic about the broader project. So that's the point I would make. It's, you know, we see goods prices coming down. We understand what will happen with housing services, but the big story will really be the rest of it, and there's not much progress there, and that's going to take some time. I think my view and my colleagues' view is that this will take some time. We'll have to hold policy at a restrictive level for a sustained period so that, you know, two good monthly reports are, you know, very welcome. Of course, they're very welcome, but I think we need to be honest with ourselves that there's, you know, inflation, 12-month core inflation is 6% CPI. That's three times our 2% target. Now, it's good to see progress, but let's just understand we have a long ways to go to get back to price stability.
Well, do you think the soft landing is no longer achievable?
No, I wouldn't say that. No, I don't say that. I mean, I would say this, to the extent we need to keep rates higher and keep them there for longer and inflation, you know, moves up higher and higher, I think that narrows the runway. But lower inflation readings, if they persist in time, could certainly make it more possible. So I don't think anyone knows whether we're going to have a recession or not. And if we do, whether it's going to be a deep one or not. It's not knowable. And certainly, lower inflation reports, were they to continue for a period of time, would increase the likelihood of a, so I would put it this way, of a return to price stability that involves significantly less of an increase in unemployment than would be expected given the historical record.
Brian. Hi, Chairman Powell. Brian Chung, NBC News. You warned Americans of pain earlier this year as the Fed hikes rates, but with the Fed now expected to raise rates higher than you thought when you first said that, just wondering where we are in that pain. How would you describe that to Americans if the projections on unemployment find themselves? That would be 1.6 million Americans out of jobs.
So the largest amount of pain, the worst pain, would come from a failure to raise rates high enough and from us allowing inflation to become entrenched in the economy so that the ultimate cost of getting it out of the economy would be very high in terms of employment, meaning very high unemployment for extended periods of time, the kind of thing that had to happen when inflation really got out of control and the Fed didn't respond aggressively enough or soon enough in a prior episode, 50 years ago. So that's really the worst pain would be if we failed to act. What we're doing now is, it's raising interest rates for people. And so people are paying higher rates on mortgages and that kind of thing. There will be some softening in labor market conditions. And I wish there were a completely painless way to restore price stability. There isn't. And this is the best we can do. I do think, though, that and markets are pretty confident, it seems to me, that we will get inflation under control. And I believe we will. We're certainly highly committed to do that.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Grady Trimble with Fox Business. You've reiterated today, and the committee has reiterated its commitment to that 2% inflation target. I wonder, is there ever a point where you actually reevaluate that target and maybe increase your inflation target if it is stickier than even you think it is?
That's just so changing our inflation goal is just something we're not thinking about. It's not something we're not going to think about. We have a 2% inflation goal, and we'll use our tools to get inflation back to 2%. I think this isn't the time to be thinking about that. I mean, there may be a longer run project at some point, but that is not where we are at all. The committee, we're not considering that. We're not going to consider that under any circumstances. We're gonna keep our inflation target at 2%, and we're gonna use our tools to get inflation back to 2%.
Nicole. Thank you, Chairman Powell. Nicole Goodkind, CNN Business. As you monitor wage growth and unemployment data, I wonder if you're paying close attention to a sector or even income level. Like, how do you factor potential exacerbations of inequality into your risk calculations, especially given the K-shaped recovery of 2020?
So the I would go back to the labor market that we had in 2018, 19, 20. So what that looked like was wage increases for the people at the lowest end of the income spectrum were the largest. The gaps between racial groups and gender groups were at their smallest in recorded history. All of that because of a tight labor market. A tight labor market which had inflation running, just a tick below 2%, and the economy growing right at its potential. So that seems like something that would be really good for the economy and for the country if we could get back to that. And so that's what all of us want to do. We want to get back to a long expansion where the labor market can remain strong over an extended period of time. That's a really good thing for workers in the economy, and we'd love to get back to that. That's what our goal is. There's in the near term, we have to use our tools to restore price stability, but what we have to think about is the medium and longer term. If you think about it, the country went through a difficult time, I think much more difficult than we can think it would happen here, but it really set up our economy for several decades of prosperity. So price stability is something that really pays dividends for the benefit of the economy and the people in it over a very, very long period of time. And so when it is lost for whatever reason, it has to be restored and as quickly as possible, which is what we're doing.
In the short term, are you factoring in these exacerbated or potential exacerbations in the economy? Are you monitoring?
We do, yes, we absolutely do. We look at, it's our regular practice to talk about unemployment rates by different groups, including racial groups and that sort of thing. We do. We keep our eye on that.
Nancy. Hi, Nancy Marshall-Genzer with Marketplace. What would you do if the economy slows so much that we enter a recession before we see strong, consistent signs that inflation is slowing? In other words, stagflation.
So I don't want to get into too many hypotheticals, but we'll It's hard to deal with hypotheticals. So let me just say that we have to use our tools to support maximum employment and price stability. I've made it clear that right now the labor market's very, very strong. You're at near a 50-year low. You're at or above maximum employment, in 50-year low in unemployment. Vacancies are very high. Wages, nominal wages, are very high. So the labor market's very, very strong. Where we're missing is on the inflation side, and we're missing by a lot on the inflation side. So that means we need to really focus on getting inflation under control, and that's what we'll do. I think as the economy heals, the two goals come more into play. But right now, clearly the focus has to be on getting inflation down.
Greg.
Thank you, Chairman Powell. Greg Robb from MarketWatch. You spoke a little bit ago. You said that the U.S. looks like we have a structural labor shortage in the economy. Could you expand on that, talk a little bit more about that? And really, are you talking about getting Congress action on increasing, like, legal immigration, things like that? Thank you.
So what I meant by that, with structural labor shortage, is if you look at where we are now, as I mentioned, if you just look at demand for labor, you can look at vacancies plus people who are actually working, and then you can take supply of labor by, are you in the labor market? Are you looking for a job or have a job? And you're more than 4 million people short. We don't see, despite very high wages and an incredibly tight labor market, we don't see participation moving up, which is contrary to what we thought. So the upshot of all that is, the labor market is actually, it's 3.5 million people at least smaller than it should have been based on pre-pandemic. Just assume population and reasonable growth and aging of the population. Our labor force should be 3.5 million more than it is, and that it can, there are easy, lots of easy ways to get to bigger numbers than that if you go back a few more years. So why is that? Part of it is just accelerated retirements. People dropped out and aren't coming back at a higher rate than expected. Part of it is that we lost 500,000 people who would have been close to 500,000 who would have been working, who died from COVID. And part of it is that migration has been lower. We don't prescribe, you know, it's not our job to prescribe things, but I think if you ask businesses, pretty much everybody you talk to says there aren't enough people. We need more people. So I tried to identify that in a speech I gave a month ago, but I stopped short of telling Congress what to do, because, you know, they gave us a job and we need to, you know, do that job.
Thanks. Jennifer?
Thank you, Chair Powell. Jennifer Schonberger with Yahoo Finance. You say you expect growth of just 0.5% next year. Given that you've said the process of raising rates and getting inflation back under control will be painful, have you had discussions within the committee and addressed how long and or how deep of a recession you would be willing to accept?
No. I mean, what we do is we make our forecasts and we publish them quarterly. And, you know, if you look at those forecasts, those are forecasts for slow growth, for a softening labor market, by which I mean unemployment goes up, but not a great deal. And you see inflation coming down. You see rates going up a lot. You see inflation coming down. Those are those forecasts, and that's really what they show. We're not, we don't talk about this kind of a recession and that kind of a recession. We make those forecasts. The staff runs, and you will see this if you look at the old Teal books, runs alternative simulations of all different kinds at every meeting, and we look at those too. And those will explore different things. But that's just upside and downside scenarios. Of course, that's responsible practice that we've carried on for many decades. But no, we don't. We haven't asked ourselves that question.
Go to Jean for the last question.
Hi, Jean Young with Market News. I wanted to ask about the SEP again. If you are reaching peak rates around 5% in the first half of next year and inflation starts to decline materially, that would seem to make the real rate gradually more restrictive. Is that something that's built into the projections and into models? Is that something you would want to see?
So we do know that, of course. That's something that we know and we'd see. But as I mentioned, that you know, we wouldn't, I wouldn't see the committee cutting rates until we're confident that inflation is moving down in a sustained way. That would be my test. I don't see us as having a really clear and precise understanding of what the neutral rate is and what real rates are, so that would mechanically happen like that. It'll be a test of for cutting rates. I think in the event, it'll be a question of, do we actually feel confident that inflation is coming down in a sustained way? Thank you very much.
Okay, let's do a quick summary and then we shall end this. Okay, so you can see market kind of like hit back up a bit, but this is very common in FOMC. You will see like during initial market come down, Jerome Powell speak, market like do a bit of crazy movement, and then after the speech is over, right, the market will digest and then it will hit in the whatever direction. Okay, so hopefully it will continue to hit down in the next 2 days for our today. The second YOLO option to come into effect. Okay, so it is actually a big recovery from this bottom point here, because at some point it was down like 1% and then suddenly it recovered to positive 0.5% like that. Okay, so now you see it is coming back down again. So this is very, very common in FOMC meeting. The price action can be all over the place, and especially if you are looking at 1 minute, right, it can be a very fast movement. So if you are not comfortable making trades in this kind of scenario, I really do suggest that you don't like add on to your losing trade, those kind of stuff. Okay, so with that said, let's roughly go through what Powell has said. Mainly, right, I can tell you there's really nothing new from what we have listened time and time again, but number one, he says that there's no pivot in 2023, and they have to stay the course. And the more important thing that he outright say is they are not focusing on the speed, meaning they are not looking at 25, 50, 75, they are not looking at the speed, but rather they are looking at the final rate, right? Okay, the final target that they want to achieve. So currently the final target they want to achieve is 5.1%. So it doesn't matter if they do 25 or 50 or whatever, like, okay, the speed is not the main issue, really. It is the final rate. And secondly, he also mentioned about the PCE, the PCE inflation. Housing related inflation account for 45%, which is coming from things like your rent, all this stuff, okay, or housing services related stuff. But he is quite confident that the housing related inflation will be coming down month after month after month, due to the fact that the mortgage rate went up and the housing market has really, really softened. But the thing with housing inflation is there is a lag period, so it will like continue to come down as Federal Reserve raise the target. But the main issue is the non-housing related services, which account for 55% of the PCE. That portion of the inflation, right, it will take substantial period to come down, and it is the portion that they are more concerned about. Okay, and aside from that, not really anything, because most of the questions that they are asking are very hypothetical questions. Okay. So it is not really related to whatever that is like going on right now. And also, I also want to find out a few things in the SCP that they mentioned, which I didn't really spot, but after the question was asked, right, it did jump out a bit. Number one, the unemployment rate have gone up, have been set higher. And not only that, you can also see that the September PCE has been from September, right, the PCE have been raised, the target PCE has actually have been raised to 3.5 from 2023. That is to say that maybe they feel that inflation is not really going to like come down that fast, because initially they think by 2023 inflation can go down to 3.1%, but actually now they think that inflation can only go down to 3.5%. Okay, so they are not really that confident yet. And there is a very funny there is a funny thing in the GDP projection. Okay, you can see September GDP projection for year 2022, right, is 0.2. But in this December projection, they raise it to 0.5. So that is a very small increment in the GDP projection, but still a small growth nonetheless. But the thing is that the 2023 projection, right, they reduce it from 1.2 to 0.5. So they actually increased the 2022 projection, but they cut the 2023 projection. So what's going on there? I'm not really quite sure. Is this like telling us that the recession coming in 2023? Who knows? Nobody knows. But it is a little weird because normally when you have when you project GDP to the upside, right, you will project across the board, but now one side is projected up, the current year get projected up, but the second year get projected down, meaning they are quite confident that Q4 might be a positive growth in GDP, but maybe Q1 next year might be a little bit different. So they are kind of like projecting in the some form of mild recession, okay? And then on top of that, they have also projected the unemployment rate upwards by another 0.2%. Okay, so now with regards to market reaction, right, I do think that there is more downside to go. There is definitely more downside to go with whatever that we see in the projection materials. Okay, so with your YOLO trades, they might get burned, unfortunately, but I mean they are YOLO trade for a reason. But your other real trades, right, your so-called your serious trade, right, they should still stay on course towards the downside, okay? Meaning I am still going to be bearish bias over the next 1-2 months like that. So I will be looking for more short position. I'll be focusing on more short position compared to long position. Of course, we will still have 1 or 2 long position nonetheless, but I will be looking at more on the short side than the upside in the coming few next one or two months. Okay. So hopefully we will see the market going down in the next 2-3 days, where market have more time to digest. And then once market digests really tomorrow or Friday, right, there will be all those like JP Morgan, Morgan Stanley will start to come out with their own analysis, and then maybe market might move from there, so who knows. And also we often do have significant movement right after the FOMC period. So like for example here, right, this is the May FOMC. So on May FOMC market rally, then immediately the next day market just U-turn all the way down, which is like it does happen quite often. I think there was another period, I forgot which period of FOMC, where market goes one direction, the next day immediately the thing U-turn. I can't remember what was the trigger or what was the cause also. So considering how market is kind of like a little bit inflated to the upside, and not only that, we do have a little bit of bearish tone coming from Jerome Powell, right? I do expect more downside now, okay? So risk is to the downside. Be very careful of your long position. Don't go all in. I don't think this is the condition to go all in on long position yet. So be more bearish buyers, but also not too bearish also, okay? We take a slightly minor bearish buyers, okay, guys? So maybe I may do a webinar tomorrow, maybe, but I mean, tomorrow as in I'm referring to Thursday. So there won't be any webinar on Thursday, but I'm also contemplating whether if I should have a webinar on Friday also, since we have like many, many rounds of webinar this week maybe. And by Friday, right, I probably will not have anything new to update you guys, but we will still have the Saturday webinar, okay? So Saturday, I will do more like an official update on whatever that happened during this particular session. Okay, guys, So it's already like, don't know, 4:30 already lah. So I'll be ending off this session. Go and I'm not sure if the World Cup is still on. Okay, guys. Go and sleep. Have a good night. Bye bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.